My son, do not forget my teachings, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace will they add to you. Do not let mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your body and strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your substance, and with your first fruits and all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your presses will burst out with new wine. Father, again, thank you for the reading of your word. I pray, Father, you would help us to understand this morning and to complete that in us, I pray. So again, I give you thanks for this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. I don't think it's any secret that anyone who knows me knows that I cannot go to any amusement park and get on any crazy ride, because if I do so, I'm going to get sick and dizzy. Now, it's been a long time since I've been to any of those things, so I forgot. Recently went to one of those places, got on a ride, and got dizzy. Now, I'm the guy that gets dizzy on the little, where you get in the elephant, and it just goes around in a circle. I get dizzy on that. So you can imagine, okay, how bad things can be. It makes my head spin, and I just get a feeling of seasickness or motion sickness, basically, is what I get. And sometimes I'll be sick all day, even into the night, you know, I'll be sick. To be honest with you, it reminds me a little bit of the world today. You know, aren't things kind of spinning and out of control and icky, and you feel sick to your stomach as you see the things that are going on around the world, the United States, and you wonder. I have people that I know that are wonderful Christ followers who are thinking the end is near. And the end may be near, my friends. But even if it is so, I will not despair. I'm not going to leave this world with anxiety. But we'll leave this world with great celebration and a heart that sings out. But I have to learn how to trust God in all things, even those things that makes me dizzy. It makes my stomach churn. It makes me not understand completely this what's going on. And to think how, I mean, I don't know if you're like this, but I sometimes will sit around and say, what can I do to fix it? What can I do to fix it? When in reality, I can't fix it. Yes. Only God can. Yes. And even in those things, God's not out to fix it. God's out to complete His will. Yes. And sometimes that means things are not going to look as well as we'd like for them. Right. Trust is not easy in this world, is it? The reason why is because so many people betray our trust in everything they do, don't they? Someone once said, never trust anyone who says, trust me. Or perhaps it makes more sense when we say, never trust a politician who says, trust me. Never trust a restaurant that advertises mom's good cooking. And there's not very many cars in the parking lot. Did you know that's the best way to find out where to eat? Drive down till you find a restaurant that has tons of cars in it. That's the place to eat. If you drive down the road and you see a restaurant that looks really good and there's only one or two cars, maybe you want to go to the next one. Never trust someone who says, I will never tell anyone else. Never trust a used car salesman who says, this car is in good running condition. Never trust a preacher who says the sermon is not that long. Never trust a clerk who says that lottery ticket is a sure winner. Never trust a company who tells you the check is in the mail. Never trust a dog owner who says, don't worry, he's never bitten anyone before. And never trust someone who says, don't worry, you'll never get caught. Listen, I'm a recipient of that. Many, many, many years ago, before Han and I both really got saved and set free, and I don't even think we had children, we went to a friend's house And he said, hey, let's go fishing tomorrow. And I said, well, Han and I don't have fishing license. He said, no problem. We won't get caught. So we went out to the fishing pond, and I took my fishing rod, and I went, zing, and I went splash in the game board and walked out of the bushes. And said, can I see your fishing license, which I did not have one. And he gave, yeah, good for him. And he gave me a ticket. I went down to the magistrate and paid my $5 and ran out of the building. But never trust anyone who says, don't worry, you'll never get caught. And never trust someone who says, then turn left and you can't miss it. Our scripture verses this morning gives us a great place to start in understanding what trust means and gives us keys of how we live successfully and acceptably to God, even though things around us seem to be filled with such great pain. And listen, I'm not making light of it this morning. I know that there are some here this morning that are going through some great challenges. I understand. My heart is broken for you. I understand the relationships that are broken. I understand the pain that people are in through relationships and emotions and through the physical. I understand that sometimes coming to church can be an emotional roller coaster, even as we are wanting to get to church to worship God, but then at the same time, we have all these things that we're struggling with. I understand, and I don't make light of it. But I do know this, that God desires for us to trust Him in all those things. Yeah. And I know that sometimes it seems like it's impossible. So let me give you four things to consider this morning when it comes to trusting God. And the first one is this. Trust God before anything else. Yeah. Let me say it again. Trust God before anything else. Yeah. Trust in the Lord, the scripture tells us, with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. You know, if you look trust up in the dictionary, and I'm one of those kind of guys, and I do a lot of word studies, and I want to understand what words mean. So if you go look up trust in the dictionary, you'll find this definition. To be confident or sure. To be bold, to be careless, to be confident, and to be hopeful. Now, I have to be honest with you, after reading that one, I thought that there was one that was out of place. I read one of those, I said, it doesn't belong there. And the one that jumped out at me was careless. How is careless in the ideal of trust? How would careless be applied this morning when we're talking about trusting? Well, I think it goes along these lines. When everything around us seems to be going south, when everything around us seems to be crumbling, when everything around us seems to be falling, when my pain is beyond my ability to hold on to, or my situation is beyond my ability to maintain, it seems like things are hopeless. But I'm here to tell you this morning that if we understand who and whose we are, we will not despair, but we'll put our total trust in God. And that means to be careless. Care less about my situation and care more about who my God is. Somebody shout amen. But see, that's really where the heart is at. I care less about the situation and care more about who God is. Amen. Now please don't misunderstand. I still have my pain. I still have my situation. But my friends, worrying about those things are not going to change them. Right. Having a stomach full of acid turning over and over and over again is not going to deliver me from that situation. In fact, all that's going to do is put me in the hospital. Right. Sick, see, with anxiety and worry. I have to find this place where I can put my total trust in God. You know, this appears to be careless in practice and thinking, but the child of God knows that God is my only hope. Who knows that this morning? Yes. That God is my only hope. The only hope we have is to get back to solid ground, my friends, and that solid ground is in Christ Jesus. Our assurance must be in God and God alone. Hear me this morning. I love doctors, and I am so very thankful that we have those that we can go to for help. But I tell you this morning, God is my healer. Yes. God is my healer. Trust has two applications here. The first one is faith. Trusting in God will require faith in God. You see, that's where with all my heart comes into. That removes my own capability from the matter. my ability and your ability in many of these matters is just so very limited, isn't it? But God has everything under control. And I know even that sometimes we say that as Christians, that God has everything under control. And we look at that and we say, yeah, sure. We may doubt even in our hearts and our minds. But my friends, even in the midst of anything that you're going through this morning, we must believe that God has everything under His control. Listen, my heart breaks for the city that I was born in this morning. My heart breaks for those that are losing their life or losing all their property or those that are struggling this morning. And they will be years to recover. Years. My mind does not understand. My spirit cannot comprehend. But I know this. I trust that God has something in place for each and every person that is there this morning. And I believe when Tom prayed, he prayed it right. God deliver those that are lost. Through tragedy, let the wings of hope rise up. In the midst of tragedy, let people be saved and delivered and set free. Let churches be empowered with His glory to touch a world around them. Those that would never darken the door of a church or listen to a sermon, let them be helped through the hands of God's people and watch and see miracles take place. Can somebody shout amen? I don't think God is in control of tearing things down, but I do believe He takes tragedy and out of that rises up hope. Yes. Anybody with me this morning? Yes. Give the Lord a clap off and a praise. Lean not on your own understanding. If we are leaning on self, then we're not trusting in God with all of our hearts. And here's the catch to this. Here's the catch. You must accept the truth that whatever about your understanding will help get you into deep trouble. In other words, whatever you're thinking will get you into trouble. Lean means to support oneself, to rely or to rest upon. We are not to rely on or support ourselves with my own understanding. Is there anyone in the house that thinks that you know better? No one would raise their hand, right? Even if they did, right? No. But you know we do that in the way that we act sometimes, the things that we say. I know what's best. God just doesn't understand. I know no one's ever said that. God just doesn't know where I'm coming from. My friends, let me help you out this morning. He knows everything there is to know about you. In fact, He knows more about you than you know about yourself, okay? And in that, He will help you if you will listen to Him. So don't lean on your understanding because you don't know anything. Our understanding is carnal, and it's influenced by the things that are going on around us. That's the reason why our heads are spinning, isn't it? That's the reason why our stomachs are churning. That's the reason why we can't understand what's going on. We say, Lord, when will the end come? And the Lord says the end will come when I say the end will come. And not before. But you as my people go forward and be the church. Be the redeemed. Be the ones that have been delivered. Be the ones that have been set free. And touch a world on my behalf. We are not to cower back into fear. We're not to go and hide in guilt or shame. We're to be the people of the Most High God. Called out of darkness and into His marvelous light. Delivered and set free. Dirty but cleansed and set up. What about you? But I've been forgiven. Not perfect, but forgiven. Yes. And called to walk in holiness. Yes. Let the world see this. I shared with my Sunday school class this morning. We are to be the showcase of the world. We're to show the world the glory of God. Yes. We're to let the world see. Listen, we're not to go around running around in fear and despair. You say, Pastor, the world is spinning out of control. Then let us stand up tall and shout the glory of God. Amen. And all. And when people ask you why, you say, look what He's done for me. Mm-hmm. Listen, I get it. I have grandchildren. Who has children or grandchildren? Oh,
amen.
I want everything to be fine and wonderful and great for them. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
So my prayers are hard and strong that they will have a great future in life. And my friends, our future and our life must be in who we are. And we are what? We are children of the Most High God.
Yes.
Why are we here? To bring glory to God. And let the world see His glory.
Amen.
If we do these things and we do them well, then we have that great faith. I won't lean on my understanding, but I lean on His. The word also tells us this trust has two applications. The first one was faith. The second one is confidence. Confidence. In 1 John 5, 14 and 15 says this. This is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to what? He hears us. So if we know that He hears whatever we ask, we know that we have whatever we ask of Him. The problem is that we have to ask, will not mine, nor yours. I love the story in 1 Samuel chapter 14 about Jonathan and his armor bearer. The Philistine army had the Israelites surrounded, and Saul was in trouble with Samuel for not following the commands of God. And Jonathan takes his armor bearer without his father's permission and goes to the Philistine garrison. And as they approach the garrison, Jonathan tells the armor bearer, "Let us show ourselves to the Philistines. If they come to us, we will depart. However, if they tell us to come to them, we will know that the Lord has given us victory over them, and we will attack." The story goes on to say that Jonathan and his armor bearer killed about 20 men in the space of a half acre. Now listen to me this morning, Anglican Everett Church. It is time for the church to take possession of the half acre. It is time for us to stand up and take that hold and stand firm in the face of all the things that are going on and say yes to God and no to the enemy. Listen, it's not time for the church to back up. Right. It's not time for the church to go hide. It's not time for the church to be in despair. It's time for us to take the half acre and bring down the enemy. Is somebody with me this morning? Yes. If we will do the things that God tells us to do, He will give us the victory.
Yes.
Anybody need victory?
Yes.
Who here needs victory this morning?
Yes.
Who here needs touch of God this morning?
Oh, yeah.
Stand your ground. Stand your ground. Don't back up, but go forward in Christ Jesus. That's where the Lord wants you and me to be, in our confidence. Someone say confidence. He wants our trust in Him to be so confident that we don't get worried while we wait on Him to meet our needs, that we have faith to understand that the outcome of everything that we do is in God's hands. I have confidence this morning that my God is still God.
Amen.
Jehovah is still Jehovah. And whatever He is doing, He's doing it for His glory and for His plan and for His purpose. What He's asked me to do is to have the confidence, to have faith, to trust in Him, to believe in Him, and to stand firm in Him. Come on. Come on. There's too much stuff going on in the world today. Too much ugliness going on in the world. Too much. I can't even begin to wrap my mind around all that. But this I know. I stand firm in who my Savior is. I stand firm in knowing who my God is. And in Him I will put my trust.
Amen.
Anybody with me this morning?
Yeah.
My second point, the first one, was to trust in God and He alone. And my second one is commit to the Lord all the areas of your life. This is what we heard through the tongues and interpretation this morning. You know, God was saying, I have the plan for your life, but you must what? Surrender to me. You have to trust in me. Commit to the Lord all the areas of your life. The scripture says, in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. The word way means a course of life or mode of action, a conversation, a custom, or a manner. In every way, acknowledge Him as the one who will supply and protect you. You must acknowledge Him as your only source of trust or supply. How many of us have heard the call of God to enter into the Holy of Holies? How many of us have heard that invitation that God says, come and meet in the Holy of Holies? And we get right up to the edge. We get right up to the doorway. And we say, that's far enough. Because you see, we have things in our life, or we're doing things, or we have attitudes that we don't want to show God. Anyone here know that God already knows what your attitude is? We'll get to the door and we'll say, that's far enough, because you see, that there is holy ground. And over here, this is safer ground. Because you see, when we step into holy ground, we risk losing everything. And that's just the way God wants it.
Yes.
He wants you completely surrendered to Him. For you see, once I step into holy ground, I take off my shoes and see. Because this is holy ground. And I must realize that I can hide nothing from God. And I must commit all my ways unto Him. Why do we stop just short of God's will? Somebody help me out. Why do we stop sometimes just short of God?
Comfort.
Comfort, yes. Maybe the first one. It's the most important one. Say it again.
Control.
Yeah, I have control when I'm out there.
Feeling not worthy.
Feeling not worthy, absolutely. God has called us to be worthy, hasn't he?
The love of yourself.
The love of self. What else?
Fear.
Fear, 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 fear. What else?
Double-mindedness.
Double-mindedness, yes.
Untrust.
I don't trust or untrust, yes.
Amen.
Listen, my friends, we have to get to that place where we commit every area of my heart to God. There once was a beggar who was invited to the house of the richest man in town for dinner. Listen to this story here, Joe. The butler took him upstairs to the bathroom, and after bathing, he was given a suit of dinner clothes. Oh, man, he looked so good. He looked like $1 million. The only negative thing was that he took his old clothes and put them in a brown paper bag and carried them with him everywhere he went. When it came time to go to the dinner table, he took those clothes with him. He placed them on his lap. The serving of the meal began, and the meat was passed by. And as he reached out to get the platter of meat, the sack of old clothes fell off of his lap. Instead of reaching for the meat, he reached down to the floor and picked up the brown sack of dirty clothes to put back on his lap. And in the process, the meat platter passed him by. Then came the potatoes. And the same thing happened. Then the vegetables. And the same thing again. He dropped his old clothes. When the last serving of food was passed by, he again reached down and picked up the old, hidden, dirty clothes. And again, he missed it. There he sat. There he sat. Dressed and looking like $1 million. With nothing but his worthless, dirty clothes. I wonder myself how many Christian followers holding on to the old stuff, missing what God has to offer them, because you see, they don't have the courage to go into holy ground because it's much more comfortable here, or it's too scary there, or I can have some control here, whereas here I don't have any control at all. Or maybe here I can put on a good show for everyone. I look good here, see. And I can fool people. But in here, I'll never fool God. Can't fool him out there either. But in your mind, you know that in here, you can fool him. Hold on to the old things. And when we hold on to those old things, we tell God that we don't trust him. My friends, can I help you out this morning? We need to let go of the dirtiness of our life and let God cleanse us up once for all and be set free and walk in his glory. And somebody shout.
Amen.
I want to be set completely free. Completely free. Completely free. Is God in control of everything this morning? That was what he asked us this morning. Is God in control of everything? Is anyone ready to start serving God and commit your life to him? Have you completely surrendered your life to him today?
Yes.
That's the answer. That's the question. Let me ask you this question. Do you know him today? Do you know Jesus? Have you committed your behavior and your general course of manners to the Lord? When we learn to surrender to God's direction, he will lead us to happiness and success. Your direction will lead you farther in what you now have. Which do you want? Which do you want? My next point is, do not overestimate your own ability. Ruh-roh. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. The sooner we realize that we are not capable of making our own decisions, the better off we will be. For you see, when I make my own decisions and insist on my own way, I always end up upside down, confused, and often defeated. Part of Hannah, my story, more my story than hers really, was that many, many years ago, probably around 15, 16 years ago, I found myself very dissatisfied with the church that I was attending and with the job that I was working at. I felt like no one was recognizing my talents or my abilities. Our girls were living out of state at that time, and they were communicating to us, looking to move to Portland, Oregon. Being dissatisfied with the job that I was in, being dissatisfied with the church that we were at, I saw a job opening in Vancouver, Washington. It would have been a promotion for me, so I applied. I was one of six called in for an interview. I drove to Vancouver, Washington, and went through the interview process. I got back to Olympia about two or three days later. I got a call to come in for the second interview. How many of you know that most people when they hear second interview thinking pretty positive stuff?
Yes.
I got the second interview. A few days later, believe it or not, I was called back in for a third interview. The last interview was with the lady who was the boss and was doing the hiring. During the interview, we both acknowledged that we were Christians, Christ followers. And much of our conversation, believe it or not, revolved around our shared faith. I have to be honest with you, I got real cocky. I knew the job was mine. A few days later, she called me. And these are her words. "John, I know I should be hiring you for the job. Your skill and your knowledge are better than anyone else we've interviewed for this position. You are my first choice. But the Spirit of God is telling me no." To say that I was disappointed would be an understatement. What did I need to do to show God and the world that I simply deserved the break? 2 weeks later, our senior pastor and youth pastor resigned, and they moved to other ministries within just a few days of each other. And the church asked me to be the interim pastor, and for 9 months, I was the interim pastor of Northwestern Life Center in Lacey, Washington. A year later, I was invited to be the pastor of Oakville Assembly of God. And almost 10 years ago, Han and I became the pastors of the Middle Lake Neighborhood Church. If I would have had my way, listen, if I would have had my way, I might not even be in ministry at all. Might be working at a state agency someplace. Just grinding out the time. For you see, I don't know what's good for me.
Right?
Neither do you know what's good for you. But God knows exactly what's good for everyone.
Amen.
I was thinking way too highly of myself, Lenny. I know you would never do that. I was thinking way too highly of myself, thinking that I had all these skills and all this talent and that God. And you know what God was doing? He was letting me stew in my own juices because I still had some maturing to do. I had some growing to do. I am so thankful that God didn't give me a ministry until I was ready for it. Let me say that again. I am so thankful that God did not give me a ministry until I was ready to do that ministry. I wouldn't change one thing. Not one thing. I am so thankful that God has the best plan for my life, and I do not want to miss Him. Anybody with me?
Yeah.
I don't want to miss Him. You see, my flesh will make the wrong turn in life. My flesh will go the easiest course. My flesh will take the most attractive route. And those ways may not be the best, you see. Because, you see, God may be taking us to the hardest, the ugliest, the least desirable route. And we may look at God and shake a fist in the sky and wonder why. But I'm here to tell you right now, God has a plan. Do not overestimate your ability, but trust in God. My fourth point is this: honor the Lord with all that you have. Somebody say that with me. Honor the Lord with all that you have. I'm always amazed, to be honest with you, at how just self-centered we can be. I'll just point the finger at me. No one else in the room is ever self-centered. I know, it's only me. We look at what we have, and then we believe somehow it's all ours. I got that. That's all mine. The children, I believe all the children are grown, teenagers, you know, the movie Finding Nemo? You know the best part of that movie? It's when the little fish jumps up on the pier, towards the end of the movie, jumps up on the pier and he's flopping around, and all the seagulls start doing what?
Mine!
All flying around, you know, trying to get over there. We're not like that, right? You know what? You haven't watched that movie? We all are, sometimes we can get so self-centered and focused on us, and this is mine. You know, in our text this morning, we're commanded to trust the Lord. Yet when we hold on to what is ours in such a way as to say to God and everyone else around us that I know better, and this time we started doing some reflection because we don't know better. The ideal of trust really shows itself in how we look at our worldly substance. I tell you right now, friends, if you want to know what's important in your life, you can go look at two places. Your calendar and your checkbook. Your calendar and your checkbook. And they will tell you what's important in your life. You see, we are told to give God the first fruits of what is really His and see how He will respond. And I have to tell you, in all the scriptures I've studied, I'm not an expert necessarily in all things, but I've read the Word over many, many times. And I can only find one place in the scriptures where we are told to test God. And it's with our finances. He says, test me, test me, test me, and watch and see. I will not give you a blessing. Now listen, I preached on tithing a couple of weeks ago, and I said that God wants to bless us. And I had a few people that got a little sideways on the blessing. So let me help you out, okay? If you can't handle money and God doesn't give you any, that's a blessing.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes we look at blessings and we think, well, it has to be just this way. Sometimes blessing is keeping you out in hot water because that's what you need to keep yourself right. But I can tell you this, God's desire is to bless His children in the ways that will benefit them and bring glory to Him. I just got through telling you how much of a knucklehead I was, how hard-headed I was, and how much direction I needed. And I'm the good guy here. No, I'm kidding. Do you hear my heart when I say that blessings don't always match what you think they should match? God is blessing you, my friends, and sometimes that's because He's maybe disciplining you at the same time. I'm not sure about anybody else in the house, but sometimes I need discipline. Listen, those are not my words, but the words of God. I know of no scripture that says we can test God except when it comes to honoring God with our giving. My friend, it's more about your attitude than your money. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
It is more about your attitude than it is about your money. So, what's going on in the world today? What's going on? Confusion. Strife. Anger. Heartbreak. I think I've shared this a couple weeks ago. Let me share it again. I've completely stopped watching the news. I no longer can stomach it. I no longer can stomach it. I no longer want to see it. I no longer want to hear what anyone else has to say. I'm done. All right. And the reason for that is because I don't trust any of it.
That's right.
At all. None of it. I don't trust any of it.
That's right.
Okay, no one. If you've got a favorite news station you like listening to, let me just tell you right now, I don't trust them either. Trust me. What I do is trust God.
Amen.
Trust God. Okay? I'm not gonna look at what's going on in the world around me to the degree that it causes me pain and heartache and trials and suffering. What I'm gonna do is say, Lord, have your way.
Yes.
And use me in whatever way I can to be a blessing to others. Can somebody shout amen?
Amen.
Am I going to get warning where warning needs to be given? Yes. But I believe God will give me the Word of God to do that.
Yes.
I don't need to see all the junk that's going on in the world. My friends, this is an evil world.
Yes.
It's a fallen world.
Yes.
that the world has been turned over to the enemy. Satan is in control of all the things that are in the world. God is in control of all things, but he's given authority to Satan to run amok.
Yeah.
And he's running amok. The question I have for you today is, are we living in the last days?
Yeah.
Are we living in the last days?
Yeah.
Are we living in the last days?
Yeah.
What is the devil going to do in the last days? He will do everything he can to deceive as many people as he can. In fact, the scriptures tell us in Matthew 24:24, for the false Christ and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. Let me tell you what the Apostle Paul said about these days we're living in 2 Timothy 3. Know this, in the last days, perilous times will come. Men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, slanderers, unrestrained, fierce, despisers of those who are good, traitors, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, and having a form of godliness but denying its power. And Paul told Timothy, stay away from such people.
Yes.
Stay away from such people. And you like every church, hear my heart this morning. As for me and my house, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And we will trust him. And we will follow him. And we will be what he has called us to be in these last days. Faithful to the very end. We are going to make sure that we understand his word. Han and I are going to make sure we understand his word.
Yes.
Han and I are going to study this word. We're going to know it from the front to the back. We're going to see how to apply it to my heart and to our lives. To live as God has called us to live. Even in the midst of craziness, we're going to live for God.
Yes.
And follow after him. If we're going to know the peace of God, mercy and truth will be the plan for our lives, and we will know the success and favor will come straight from that. We will know that no matter what the conditions of our physical bodies, our spiritual bodies will have strength and health. We will be faithful stewards of God, knowing that if we are, we can never outgive God. I ask you this question. When the tongues of interpretation were given earlier, the Lord said he had great plans and direction for your life. God said that he would be with you, and he is. But he said there are some that are not completely surrendered to him. There are some that haven't given themselves completely over to him 100%. If that is you, and you know that is you, would you stand to your feet? Would you stand to your feet? He said, Pastor, I don't want to be embarrassed. I don't want people to talk about me. No one should be talking about you because they should be standing also. If that's you, stand here. And you want to know, stand here. Know it's you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Savior. Father, I just want to pray for these who are standing. I know. I understand. Your word, not only through scripture, not only through preaching, but also through the gifts of the Holy Spirit, told us very clearly today that we worry way too much about what we see on television. We worry way too much about what's going on around us. When you have said very clearly that the end is near, that the time is coming, when if possible, even the very elect can be deceived. Father, I pray for those that are standing, and for those that are not standing and should be. Help them to surrender to you this morning. Help each and every person to surrender to you completely. And say, Lord, not my will, but thy will be done in everything that I do. I surrender all, Lord God, to you this morning. And I give you thanks for those who are committed to that service. Let's all stand together and sing our closing song.